My name is Ed Israel. My company is Plural, Additive Manufacturing. And we are an additive manufacturing integrator. And I'm still working on what that definition means in today's market. But fundamentally, it means that it has we're involved with every aspect of implementing this technology in the company from upgrading the slicer to helping companies formulate their own materials, to working with the manufacturer of our products for upgrades to the printer. So we represent a printer line out of Italy for North America. And for the last year or more, we've been deeply involved in implementing systems and companies all across the board, from industrial machinery companies to sporting goods companies. And so what we're finding, we've also been doing case studies for a long time, looking at the cost, the ROI of actually moving from the concept of just rapid prototyping to actually producing end-use parts. So,
okay.
So this is just kind of representing a range of parts that we've been involved in, from marine manifolds to printing real rubber soles for companies like Under Armour, to creating wire grommets, to building our own. Our 3D printers have actually about a dozen 3D printed parts in them that save the manufacturer about $20,000 for every 50 printers that goes out. To air plenums, to bellows or hoods, to self-lubricating material gears, to fixtures, to what I'll talk about a little bit later, the world's first Jello shot machine, okay? That is kind of an amazing thing, and we get to sample it every Friday. So anyway, so the current technologies, they've really grown quite a bit over the years, and they've grown, many of them are still just prototyping technologies, but FDM and certainly metals are technologies where you can move into actual production parts. What's not on here yet, because it hasn't been delivered yet, but HP's multi-jet fusion printer, which is coming next year, which is going to be a whole new technology that will speed up the process and basically be a competitor to the SLS world of 3D printing. So if anyone doesn't know what a particular acronym is, just ask me and I'll tell you. So go ahead. God, I hate this. And so what do they make? So with SLA, you're doing prototypes. You're not going to be doing much in the way of end-use parts or low-volume parts. With FFF or FDM, you certainly are. With SLS and DMLS, you will. And with the others, you're doing primarily prototypes. And even with EBM and some titanium alloys, you're doing end-use parts as well. So one of the things I hope you'll walk out of here today with is the fact that our belief that 3D printing is not additive manufacturing. And one of the things that drives me crazy in our industry, and some of the world leaders use that term interchangeably. In fact, if you even go in the dictionary or up on the web and you look up 3D printing, it'll say additive manufacturing, and if you look up additive manufacturing, it'll say 3D printing. They're really different things. And so that's a definition right off the web. And it's really about just defining, it's not a manufacturing process, it's printing a part or two. I mean, it's an additive process for sure, but it really needs to stay just in that vein of 3D printing. And in fact, the original term was rapid prototyping. In 1995, MIT Labs coined the term 3D printing, and the term rapid prototyping just kind of went away, mostly because the whole consumer world picked up the concept of 3D printing. So we see two different definitions for additive manufacturing. One is that it's basically taking what you saw before, if you want to put the end for me, and it's taking those same parts, but it's creating them in volumes that are repeatable, industrial parts. And when we say industrial, we mean that they are dimensionally tolerant within manufacturing tolerances, and that they are repeatable. Those are what we consider to be industrial grade parts. The not so simple definition, the one that we think is going to have the same impact that when CNC machines hit the shop floor, what it did for businesses, is it's going to be a whole new way that you think about your business. So we're going to walk through a few of what some of those things are, because it really is. In fact, we're seeing this in companies now. Companies that have said, well, I don't have any need for this, to a walk through the warehouse and looking at parts and asking, you know, is that part metal for a particular reason, or how are you producing that particular plastic part? We begin to talk, and the next thing you know, there's this whole learning experience that occurs from actually just having a discussion about how those parts are made. And most parts are made based on traditional DFM, design for manufacturing. They're designed for the constraints of the machines that you can actually manufacture them with. So one of the first things that's pretty critical is, over the years I've worked with companies where their customers required that the parts were, or the products were already made and were put on the customer site, and they didn't have to be paid for until they were used, all the way to, you know, build it on demand, okay? So one of the things you can now do is go ahead and click the, you can move from having finished parts, because you know how long these parts take to print, you know how much material you need, you know what the costs are going to be, and you know all of that before you even print the part. And based on your customer's forecasts, you can produce these kinds of parts pretty quickly. So we move from finished parts now to just, in this particular case, in the FDM world, with just spools. Or maybe you've got powdered materials if you're doing SLS, or powdered materials if you're doing DMLS, which is the metal printing. And what we're finding now that people are really interested in, especially that start with low volumes and want to move to large volumes, is the ability to have a filament made that is that you use for your low volumes, and then when you move to your higher volumes, you can actually have your pellets made out of that same material. So you're moving with the same properties all the way along, which is really nice, and there are a lot of companies that are interested in that. Go ahead. So spare parts on demand. So you've got IOD, inventory on demand, spare parts on demand. So go ahead and just you can click the three pictures. So this is a real scenario, and it shouldn't have to exist in the marketplace today. You all know who Coleman is. You know, they make great outdoor equipment. But occasionally a part's going to break. And a friend of mine bought one of their more expensive tents, had it for about 18 months, and then this plastic part broke. This plastic part held four poles together that held the screen room together for the tent. So they call up Coleman and say, hey, I need that part. Oh, well, that tent's discontinued. I know, you know, that never happens, but it happened to him. And they said, well, okay, that's no problem. I just need the part. Well, we don't have the part. Well, why not? Well, we never had the part because it was all assembled in China and it was all came, so we never really had any spares. So clearly in this particular situation, customer service is not talking to engineering or manufacturing. Because my friend spent a day and a half on the phone dealing with this thing. They finally sent him a whole new screen room. Cost them a lot of money and cost them a customer who's probably not going to buy from Coleman again. They'd had a little industrial 3D printer, which isn't very expensive. Customer service calls up, or you get that same call, hey, I'm missing this part from this stand. Oh, no problem. We can print it. We'll have it for you in a few days. This part is so simple, it'll probably print in about 30 minutes, 40 minutes. And they might even want, it's so inexpensive, they might even want to print, because I'm sure they've had a history of these breaking. They want to print a half dozen of them. It's pennies to do that. So that would have solved it completely. And by the way, the spare parts industry is going to be exploding new businesses. I mean, we've all called to try to find new parts for our refrigerators and our microwave ovens and our dishwashers. Well, now you'll be able to call up and have it printed. So whether it's from the manufacturer or another company who buys the drawings or the files, or as a scanner and get their hands on the part. So you can go to the next one, Sarah. Thank you. Design. Creativity. I mean, this is an Airbus part that Airbus has over 1,000 3D printed parts on their A320. And this is the old part right here. The new part was designed with 48% less weight and more rigidity. And that's one of the things that additive manufacturing brings to you. And that's what we call DFAM, design for additive manufacturing. The constraints are so few because you're starting with nothing and you're building, so you can create hollows, you can create variable wall thicknesses, you can create different forms of infill, which we'll show you in a little bit. So this is an example of what's going on. And when people send us parts to print to see if they want to obtain, you know, one of our products, we're almost always redesigning those parts because they're, again, designed for manufacturing. They're not designed for additive manufacturing. So we'll generally send them back the part that they wanted, and then we'll send them back another part that sometimes doesn't look anything like it, but accomplishes the same thing. This is an insane story from GE. GE makes the LEAP engine, and the LEAP engine had originally about, I don't know if it was 18 or 20 individual fuel nozzles in it. And each one of those nozzles were about 17 to 20 different parts that all had to be welded together. Incredibly expensive. They took on a project that lasted a fair bit of time, and the same part now is printed in metal out of one part. And it's also somewhere between 20 to 25% more efficient from a fuel standpoint. So for each airplane that has these fuels, these nozzles in it, they're saving several million dollars a year in just fuel, just from that. So GE took a big risk, huge risk, and then they bought a company out of the Midwest, and they have probably $200 or $300 million DMLS machines, and they're cranking out these fuel nozzles as well as other things. So additive manufacturing right now still is really in the higher end of the aerospace world and in the medical world, but it's starting to move downstream into the masses. And part of that has been part cost or machine cost and material cost. That's all coming down to the point now where we are literally seeing, like I said, we've been doing case studies now for companies that are, we've been working with a drone company for a while, and they machine three parts out of plastic right now for their drone, and they print 80 of those a month. So you do the math on how many parts that is to have a machine, cost them around $8,000 or $9,000. With three printers, they can produce those same parts for $3,500 a month, amortized over a 5-year period. So they're immediately saving $4,000 or $5,000 a month, bam, 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 right now. And that is additive manufacturing, right there, on a smaller scale. Another thing about the traditional manufacturing world versus this new world is factories everywhere. And so you're flying everywhere versus in many miles and lots of dollars versus having printers stationed all over the world where you can start producing parts to a product or the entire product. So that whole localized, regionalized manufacturing, building closer to the customer, working closer with the customer on the designs is all available to you. So here's one case study. For those of you that have been to our booth, you've seen this part. This is a part that's probably about 5 inches by about 10 inches, and it's an RF shield for a circuit board. And the company that we're working with is a global company, and they spend, this is done out of ABS right now, but it could be done out of several different types of plastics. They spend $600 to have this machined out of aluminum, and it takes 4 to 6 weeks to get. Then they have a little FIP conductive gasket put on the top of that, and then that gets screwed down over the circuit board, and because they want to be able to protect from things like crosstalk, signals talking to one another inside of a real sensitive circuit board. We said, gosh, that's a lot of money, and gosh, that takes a lot of time. So we found a company that could take that same part and actually metallize it. It's called vacuum deposition or vacuum metallization. And that can be done on a lot of different parts, and we have a couple parts up in our booth that we can show you. This took 11 hours to print this, pennies in material cost. Probably if you amortize for the volume that they would need for these shields, if you amortize this over 5 years, this part, all said and done, probably is $150 versus that $600. Now, if you're machining in multiples, then that price will come down, but it'll still be a lot less. Plus, you can iterate this process, obviously, and reprint. So we then tested this plastic part against an aluminum part by sending signals in, different types of signals into the circuit board, and make sure there was no leakage, and it worked just as well. The electronics engineer, the mechanical engineer was stunned, and they went, wow. We now see time to market issues, you know, a benefit. We see cost as a benefit. We see iterating our shields as a benefit. And now they're figuring out how to speed up the manufacturing of their circuit boards. So that becomes another thing. So that's an example of an application that you can actually take to additive manufacturing in low volumes. And when we talk about low volumes, because additive manufacturing is a low volume game, but low volume is all relative, depending on the size of the part and the complexity of the part. So if you are printing a small part, you might be able to create, and you could have a bank of printers with print farm software, you might be able to print thousands a month, and you just simply do the math. We can actually do the math before you even have to spend a dime. All we need is that step file, or we'll take an STL file if we have to, but a step file, and we can absolutely tell you the cost of building those parts or a range of parts over multiple years amortizing the printer before you even spend a dime. So you begin to learn about the ROI, and then you get to look, start to learn about what parts might become valid. So the next case study was a fun one. And this is a company out of Oregon that actually developed a Jello shot machine that will create 20 Jello shots in 10 minutes. And so they have several thousand pre-orders from bars all over the country right now for this product. But what's even more valuable is the concept of medical dosaging. So they are actually working with medical clinics as well, where someone can't swallow a big pill or won't take one, a kid won't take one, you can now mix that medicine in with a Jello shot, but it's not vodka, it's the medicine, and with a whole range of different Jello combinations, and so there's a really excellent medical application for this as well. But this is a great story. So there's about seven or eight parts. This is a little mini manifold, this is a little mini drain pump housing, and what their issue is that probably the first 2,000 of these that go out will be still, there'll be production, but they're going to change because they get out into the marketplace, people go, God, it's a little too tall, it's a little too wide, I need this, I need that. So until they've really nailed their market after the first 1,000 or 2,000 machines, they'll then be able to justify going to Tula. So right now I'm going to show you a cost model of what this is saving them up to their first, you know, 800 machines or so, or I think this shows like if for every 200 machines, this is what they'll save. So this is an opportunity that we probably iterated these parts three or four times when they thought that they were done. But we actually acted as a service bureau for these guys. We're not a service bureau, we don't want to be a service bureau, but this is such an interesting project and it was right down the street from us and we wanted some Jello shots and we decided to do the service bureau work for them. And so we iterated multiple times, like I said, when their lead designer thought they were done. And then they put it all together, something fails, they go, oh gosh, we need this size, whatever. So we ended up printing 50 or 60 parts for them in overtime until they go to a contract manufacturer that will then assemble it. So, and then again, we were there on a Friday afternoon and they said, well, we want to test out our watermelon and our cinnamon and our
birthday cake
and all this kind of stuff. And so I go up now every other Friday and they give me a tray of these and I bring it down to the office. And for prospects that come to see us later in the day, you know, we sit down and have a chat, and I get a Jello shot or two. I'm not kidding, by the way. So, anyway, they also like the story. It's kind of fun. So, here's an example of their savings, because they don't have to tool up right now. Because the tools for these parts cost anywhere from $9,000 to $15,000. And so right now, for every 200 GVOs per month, that's what they're calling the machine, those are the four parts. The injection mold cost, for 200, you know, building the tool and amortizing the tool over 3 years, the cost is $16. The 3D printed cost is $8.90. You roll all the way through it. So for every 200 machines, they're saving $8,000. But they're saving a hell of a lot more than that because they don't have to iterate. They don't have to pay for new tooling because they know they'd have to do that up until they get their final production run. So this is incredibly valuable for them. And it's an example of additive manufacturing. In fact, he said, the head of product development said, we may not even go to injection mold tools. And I said, well, you're probably going to want to because there's a curve that says once you hit certain volumes, if you know and you're sure there's going to be those volumes, it's going to be cheaper to build a tool for injection molding. Because injection molding, where its benefit is for tens of thousands and hundreds of thousands and millions, you know, you build the tool. You amortize the tools over all those parts, it's pennies. But for this number and for the kind of volume they expect to do it, they probably will go to injection molding. But then they may have a new machine out by the time that happens and then they start all over again. So this iterative process really helps them a lot. We did a presentation for an energy summit, and what this really showed was kind of the two traditional and then additive manufacturing models. And we said, okay, what's the what's the time, what's the cost, what's the energy footprint? And the energy footprint for this kind of technology is substantially lower than machining or injection molding, but unfortunately, we only have anecdotes right now, we don't have actual data yet, because there are not enough companies really cranking this out in terms of a manufacturing model yet, but basically the requirements documents are about the same, the design is about the same, the RFQ, you don't even really need an RFQ for this. And then the cost is roughly half. I mean, we literally are saving that drone company, in this case, over half. We just did a cost analysis. Actually, we did it, and then a huge industrial machinery company out of Illinois did it. Name will go unmentioned. And their internal cost versus another method of doing this, we were 75% less cost to deliver this for them. I mean, it was a no-brainer, absolute no-brainer for them. And then energy, again, it's anecdotal, but we're really seeing a substantially less energy being used for this footprint, less waste. You know, all the plastic the plastic that's not being used, the support material gets pulled off, that's all recyclable, you know, reground for hobby printers, you know, that type of thing. Next. So in terms of the market, I will tell you that, and I've been starting to tell this to a lot of the folks that we talk to, is that we really believe this is inevitable. It's a matter of when for every company out there. But when you look at these kinds of forecasts, this is back right around, you know, Stratasys started in the mid-80s, 3D systems in the mid to late 80s, and it was just a very slow grind, rapid prototyping, going. Then it started getting broader industry adoption, consumer products. And then, bang, the transition from rapid prototyping to AM are right around this time. And they expected to jump to be a 16 to 20, I mean, I've heard 24 billion by the year 24. And that's a big market. That's a huge market. So what does that mean for suppliers to major manufacturers? You know, what does it mean to major manufacturers? What does it mean to that whole supply chain in terms of what role they should play? And we're seeing this. I mean, we're seeing these kinds of numbers, these kinds of upticks. I can't believe the interest level that's coming now. This is the obligatory Jeffrey Moore crossing the chasm slide, but it still applies. And that is, we're finding that companies that obtain our technology sooner, they become experts in it, and they're able to move faster for their customers. And then just like in any cycle, you're going to have people that come in at the top, and then catch up, and then you got to have to survive. And at that point in time, it costs you a hell of a lot more to get into the game at that point. So the ability to learn about the ROI in advance before you spend a dime, the ability to help determine what parts are valid that you could actually do, what parts could change from metal to plastic just because you've always done them in metal, and you know, maybe you've got to weld three pieces together and you can create a little manifold or a little duct with one part. You know, why wouldn't you consider doing that? So the kinds of questions that you need to be asked about whether AM makes sense for your business is, now obviously we're in the plastics game, but this same thing would apply to metal as well. But metal is a whole different world for 3D printing. It's the expense level is so much greater, and the way in which you deal with support is kind of archaic in terms of how you have to cut off the supports and so forth. But there's it's a huge market that will be growing, obviously. So how are you making these parts today? You know, are low volume, again, volumes could be tens a month to thousands a month, depending on what the part is itself. Can you save money? Two things that I think are critical for manufacturing companies are cost and quality. Can I get the same quality? Can I get repeatability? Can I get the tolerances, you know, plus or minus 5 thou or better? What can I get? What about materials? There's got to be, 25,000, a library of 25,000 plastic materials in the injection mold business. You know, it's a lot of time when we talk with injection mold companies, they say, here, we need this material. Well, it may not be a filament yet, but, you know, we look to try to get it as close as we can. For those of you that are not familiar with the term infill, because you're printing from nothing, you've got to have some kind of structure inside or it'll just collapse. So there's octagonal infill, there's straight infill, there's round infill, and the amount of infill that you put in is all totally dependent on what the part requirement is. What are the stresses? Where are the stresses? For the Under Armour shoe, they're looking at different shorterometers of rubber. They're looking at round infill versus straight infill, because round infill is maybe a little bit less compression than straight infill. So there's so many combinations that you can work with infill. So it gives you an opportunity to really work with your customers. Weight reduction. Everything we're doing, when we send out our sample parts, they're like 10% infill. They're really light. If you come to our booth, I'll show you some. They're really light. all the way up to, we printed some solid parts for some fixtures because of the pressures against the fixtures. So, but generally speaking, you don't need to go more than 33, maybe 40% infill. And then the structure can change as well. So your costs are really dropping. Next, Sarah. More is AM right for you. The concept of inventory on demand. Reducing your carrying costs, you know, just having inexpensive spools of material versus having finished inventory. Spare parts, big problem for lots of companies, especially for ones that say, we'll take care of you for 20 years after the product's been the life of the product. So, redesigning from plastic, or from metal to plastic. So just a few conclusions about additive manufacturing. Really important that you think about it as something, it's a whole new way of thinking about your business. If you just bring in a 3D printer and start cranking out some parts, that's fine. But if you really want to start changing how you do business, how you interact with your customers, the opportunity is there. And if you start early, the costs aren't very high, and you can reduce your prototyping costs now and improve the quality of your prototyping, and you can literally produce parts in plastic. If your end-use parts are metal, you can produce parts in plastic that are so good with form, fit, and function that you can go right to final production from these plastic parts. Final production in metal. One of the penalties that low-volume manufacturers pay, the cost for their tooling as much as the cost for tooling for, you know, running it more generally speaking. It will change the business. We're starting to see businesses start to evolve their own thinking. We get calls going, hey, do you think we could, you know, stop the print and insert metal? Do you think we can stop the print and run a trace through? You know, can we print new materials out of barium sulfate? It's for radio opacity to be able to make sure that something doesn't get left in the body after surgery. And we think this is kind of a catalyst for the next industrial revolution. Materials for 3D printed parts are one of the three fastest growing technologies in the world right now. The requests, I wish to God somebody just needed a simple ABS part. It would be really nice. But we get asked for polycarbonate with thin walls. We get asked for all sorts of crazy things. But that's because people are wanting to see what you can actually do. And we're actually coming up with new aerospace materials right now that we'll have. So it's amazing. In fact, I would be stunned if we didn't have our own material scientists within another year or so. It's such an important part of that business. So I wanted to spend just a quick second I know that Siemens wanted me to talk a little bit about the STEM programs. You guys all know what STEM is? Okay, so science, technology, engineering, and math. So I was lucky enough when I was in school to, when I was in seventh and eighth grade, I was able to take mechanical drawing, I was able to take metal shop, wood shop, and there's been at least a generation or two that have lost that in our education right now. Now, obviously, once the U.S. saw, you know, jobs going overseas and manufacturing going overseas, that they just really pulled that out of education, which is really a shame because the education I got kind of changed me. I have a friend who from his seventh grade mechanical drawing class is now a lead architectural engineer, and he travels the world doing designing fab plants for Intel. That's where it started from, was seventh grade, you know, mechanical engineering class. So we're working with some STEM teams. We're working with some STEM teams, and I've visited a few, and I've been to some events in the Northwest, and it absolutely blows my mind what these high school kids are able to do, and I'll show you a few pictures. But this top one, Marine Advanced Technology Education, MATE, this group of young kids in eighth grade built an autonomous ROV that goes under the water, and they 3D print, and we 3D printed a claw for them. They went underneath, they were able to pick something up and bring it back up to the surface. That was one of the national challenges. What those kids learned from that was absolutely unbelievable. They're in the TARC program, so they do two projects a year. They have to, this is a national program for STEM teams, they have to shoot a rocket, they have to design a rocket, propel it, they have to put an altimeter in it, it has to go up exactly 800 feet, it has to have a transition that separates it, and then a parachute brings an egg down, a raw egg down, unbroken. We're going to see that in May, but by the time they're done, these kids are gonna, I mean, they're gonna be engineers without degrees. I mean, they're gonna have jobs coming right out of high school. And so it's really cool. Siemens has really worked very closely with us, and we're putting Solid Edge, and we're giving these kids Solid Edge. We're training them on Solid Edge. We are, because our background is also in CAD as well as rapid prototyping and product design. But these kids are doing amazing stuff. It just blows my mind. And my son missed this generation. Can we go to the next one? So this is their ROV, and I'll show you this part right here. They had it in three parts before we saw them. So we sat down and talked to them about additive manufacturing, about the idea of instead of multiple assemblies, why not build one part? And we didn't tell them how to do it. We just told them what they should consider. And they completely redesigned this motor, prop guard, and then connecting to the ROV all by themselves. And they finished third nationally with this project. And so, and I'll show you, they did a redesign of this part right here. And they did the design themselves, and we're doing the 3D printing for them because we can't afford a 3D printer. Go ahead, next. This is the transition tube that they designed on their own. This is what separates the lower and the upper part of the rocket so they can bring the egg down. This was the original god-awful camera thing that they had. They redesigned this part, they reduced the weight, they found a smaller camera. And this is, they got this for all like 10 or 20 bucks. I mean, the camera and this, they designed and printed for them for nothing. So these kids are coming out with, they're walking in and asking us questions like, wow, we could ask these questions from engineers that we talk to. You know, it's absolutely amazing. And we're starting to see this move in the country, and Siemens is very deeply involved in this process as well. Next picture. These guys are crazy. These guys have actually started working with prosthetics. And these are high school kids, juniors and seniors. And if you go to the next slide, Sarah, this is a guy that kind of got them started with it, but he basically was a bike racer that fell and lost all of his fingertips. And so they're now working and actually helping him with a workable item. And it's unbelievable the kinds of things that they're learning right now. I mean, they're designing the circuit boards. They're having them made, they're designing the circuitry, they're doing all of these things themselves. So, I wanted to put that in there because I think that any chance that anybody has to get their kids involved in STEM programs, it's unbelievable. I mean, these kids are racing to the top like nothing I've seen before. I was at an event just recently, I was blown away listening to these kids talk. They sounded like they've been in industry for a couple of years, other than the fact that they, you know, sweating and freaking out a bit, but what they had to say was pretty amazing. So questions, bored, I gotta get out of here. Not me, but questioning that. You know, I mean, what comes to mind? I mean, where does this fit in your business? Does it fit in your business? What kind of questions do you have? Do you understand the difference between a hobby printer and an industrial printer? Most people in industry have hobby printers, try them a few times, and then they're in the closet. Because the engineers shouldn't be taking their time trying to make something happen for days and days and days, and it's never going to happen. So, I answered all your questions. That was awesome. So, well, that was pretty much it.
We'll go with it.
Yeah.
So, can you coat plastic to make it stronger versus just coating for like RF or something like that?
There are different coatings available that can do that. I'm not knowledgeable on that, so I would want to step back from it, but it's certainly an answer I could get for you because we answer every question that we get because we're going to get it again. But there are different types of coatings out there that are possible for post-processing in terms of strength. The strength issue, though, is there are some plastics out there that are seriously strong as they sit. So it kind of depends on what the answer is. I think the answer is yes. I would need to get a little bit more information on that, at least from some of the people that know a hell of a lot more than I do, you know, in the materials game. But what you can do with some plastics right now and the hardness of some of these new plastics coming out and the strength and elongation, it's crazy. So you may not need that. It depends. By the way, it depends is one of the most commonly used term in our business. Can we print 1,000 a month? It depends. Mm-hmm. How fast can my printer go? It depends. Because there's, you know, if you want dimensional accuracy, if you want surface quality, if you want this, that, you know, whatever it may be. Dan?
I think most of the, I wanted to ask the audience here, no, I kind of work for the solid edge group planning group. And if any of you are looking at 3D printing and want to see some of the things, what you would like to see in solid edge would be useful input for us. So if you have any questions on anything, feel free to talk to Ed or you can talk to us in solid edge on more about what you would like to see and where you want to see solid edge take you to. So, and I'll be here till tomorrow evening, so feel free to come and talk to me on what you're doing. And we would also like to know is if any of you are using any of the 3D printing capabilities as part of your regular manufacturing processes, or if you're evaluating the technology or what stage you are interested in. So that would be helpful for us to kind of provide a direction to solid edge. So feel free to come talk to us also.
Thank you, Dan. So this is another example of what I like to think of as an additive manufacturing integrator. So we've had customers ask us or say, I hate that STL file. Now you're taking perfectly good geometry and you are turning it into triangles and then you're printing it because that's what the printer needs. So we're working on a project with Siemens right now to not necessarily eliminate the STL file completely, but to really create a better conversion so you get much, much higher resolution. So when you're going around a curve, you don't necessarily see the striations, you see more like a real curve. So that's one thing that is being asked for. Another thing is finite element analysis. You know, you can beat the hell out of a part in software to help determine what's the best thing that you can do. Can't do that with 3D printed parts yet. So the next step is to be able to actually do analysis of 3D printed parts in software. So we say, when is the layer going to separate? What's the best orientation to print in? And so those are the kinds of things that we get asked. And so we look at a partner like Solid Edge, and they're the first ones we came to. And we're going to be working on that with them to be able to create that, along with our slicer developer, to be able to deliver that. If you come to our booth, we'll show you that we're printing with patterns now. You can actually print patterns on parts. And it's rudimentary right now, but ultimately we want to move to be able to, your company has a pattern, you know, you import that pattern, and you know, we're not there yet by any stretch, but that's where we want to head, to be able to actually do that as well. So there's just, it's kind of like blue sky, you know, lots of really, every time we get a question from a customer we go, or a prospect we go, is that worthy? Yes, it's worthy. We're going to talk to our slicer developer and see if this is something that we can add into the software. So in a closed system, you can't do that, but we're an open system, so you have the ability to do that.
So why is it just because STL has been the original 3D file?
Right.
Everyone has pretty much, I mean, obviously the hobby stuff. I mean, I have a hobby printer, but everyone just hopped on, and it's been easy. Because it is, I mean, it's the worst file to use. I mean, all the share sites of, like, hobby toys and stuff, I mean, I have maybe one out of 20 parts I make are actually photos for business or toys for my nephew.
Yeah.
But, I mean, there's so many share sites, and I can't believe that there's that many consumers that download stuff, and they have to jump through hoops with, like, free CAD stuff to be able to edit, and it's a pain in the ass. I mean, it's horrible.
So your question is?
Well, just why is, I mean, obviously, you just kind of mentioned possibly a different type of editing in that.
Right,
file.
Right.
Why is that still the norm-based file type?
Probably because nobody, I mean, what it takes is somebody to say, I don't like it that way and change it. Right now, you know, it works. It's not on people's radar necessarily, but because, for example, with our company, we've been living in the world of CAD. We come from a CAD and rapid prototyping and product design world, and precision is absolutely critical. And so the more you can improve that, I mean, we're actually kind of glad that nobody's done that, because if we can do it, Solid Edge will have the first one that does it. But it just takes somebody that decides that they want to go fix it, you know, I guess. And it apparently isn't enough of a problem for enough people. And in the consumer world, you know, I mean, everyone has a different idea of what they want to do there. Anyway, and but the other thing though is you've got to get to G code, right?
You can just edit an IDIS. You can't edit an STL.
Yeah, you can't, and that's why we only want step files or native files, because a lot of times we get STL files in that don't have good resolution. So we print a part, and it's like, I'm not showing this to these guys. Ring, ring, ring. Can I have your step file, please? Now we just ask for that to begin with. because we just don't want to, we want to deliver a part that they go, wow, okay, this is real, this isn't a toy. Unfortunately, the hobby world has kind of created the idea that there's still a real toy aspect to 3D printing, because smaller industrial companies don't want to go spend the big money, and maybe they shouldn't, so they go buy a hobby printer, try and make it work, oh, this is garbage. Next thing you know, it's like, we walk in and we want to talk about 3D printing, not 3D printing, forget it. You know, so you got to fight that hurdle first, you know, before you, because they've had maybe a bad experience. So, but I didn't give you a very good answer, but it's just,
it's
just that it's not, it's clearly not an issue for enough people yet to deal with that. And when we do this, it's only going to be available for Solid Edge initially, because it's got to be within Solid Edge, it's got to be within our slicer. All right, so then we're going to have to look at each CAD system after that, you know, at some point in time. So whether we do it or not is another story. You had a question? Oh, yeah. Hey, man.
That was actually essentially what you just said. You mentioned that people are starting to play around with 3D printing, and they decide to invest $2,000, $5,000 into a desktop printer, and they try a few things out, and then it ends up in the closet. So what would you recommend people who are just starting to jump into the game, like who don't have, you know, who are not large enterprises who can spend a lot of money on printing hardware to get started?
The first thing I would recommend is don't go buy something. Okay, that's what I would recommend. I would find a good, smart reseller of industrial printers, and I would tell them that, honestly, we're thinking about this, okay? And they should want to work with you all the way down the line. If you're someone that says, I mean, we work with companies say, look, I'm not going to buy for a year. I go, I don't care, because every customer we talk to, or prospect we talk to, I get educated. I learn something else. That's how we got the metallized plastic. From talking with a company that wasn't looking at a 3D printer. Now, the metallized plastic is one of the hottest things kind of we have going. So find a vendor and learn how to vet a vendor, okay, for they should be willing to share costs with you. They should be willing to sell material costs, run costs with you. They should be willing to do an ROI for you. They should be willing to print a part for you. All of these things. If they're not willing to do that, then they're only interested in selling you a printer. They're not interested in helping you bring a new manufacturing process into your company. I absolutely guarantee it. And so you look for those, and you talk to them, and you begin to learn. You get educated. And all of us as companies need a pipeline. I don't care if I'm talking to someone that's buying a year from now. They may buy earlier, but they may buy a year from now. I'm going to learn, they're going to learn, and we'll continue to converse over time. But I think that's really key. This is like the PC world way, way back when, you know? God, you know, open up the United Airlines magazine, go, God, I can get one of these for, you know? And doesn't work very well. The OS is a hybrid DOS OS, you know, whatever it may be. From when, I'm showing you my age now. Basically, there are good people out in this industry that really want to help customers and, you know, help people learn this. And you could either start by taking some courses in schools. Unfortunately, most schools can't afford to buy industrial printers. Some have them, some don't. But and we educate a lot of kids, too. In fact, we see using interns doing a lot of our material science work. We're going to work with Oregon State University, and they're going to use their interns to start, you know, studying and testing materials for us. How strong is ASA really? But that's what I would do. I would find a good vendor, and you're going to know immediately. I mean, there's a series of questions that you're going to ask very quickly that you know whether you think they're a good vendor or not, you know? Are they willing to talk to you, you know? Are they interested in learning about your business? What do you do? Or they just want to talk about the benefits of the printer, okay? You know, learn about all of those things, glean as much information as you can, and then just, you know, at some point make a decision. They should print a part for you or two. They should work with you about the best way to print the part. They should not charge you for the part initially, and this is all part of their learning experience as well as ours. And so that's what I see that you should be able to do.
Question. Would you mind doing us a guest plug on Solid Edge blog on 3D printing and stuff? Can you do a guest blog?
A guest blog?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay.
Absolutely.
I'll put you in touch with Matt Lombard.
Absolutely. You bet.
Because this is a good question, because, you know,
yeah,
we kind of can come up with a series of posts on 3D printing and how people should start looking at it.
Yeah.
It would be useful for a lot of Solid Edge customers.
So somebody my age should be close to retirement by now, but I'm seriously passionate about what we're doing right now. And I've told a lot of people even here at this event that I feel like I'm kind of in my second childhood because I'm playing with, you know, big boy and girl toys right now, and you get to do really cool stuff and learn stuff all the time, and you know, it's amazing. And this is the beginning. We're really at that one slide. We're right 2016, man. That's when the hockey stick is going to start going up. So the question the point is, we believe it's going to be inevitable. You need to determine to what degree it can benefit your business, and you should look for companies that can help you do that. And as I said, you're welcome to come up and see some of the different parts and ask about them and tear them apart and try to break them. Well, so.
Yeah. And then Ed's also going to be on the additive manufacturing roundtable discussion tomorrow morning at 10. So if you want to just kind of get a feel for that as well, there will be other companies representing there.
And I think after that, we have a session from at least the PL and Solid side and what we are looking at it and what are the things we plan on doing. So you can also come join that session also after the panel discussion on 3D printing stuff.
Well, I hope you found some percentage of this valuable in terms of what you take away. And feel free to stop by. I'll be here till the end of the day tomorrow in terms of any questions you might have. Thank you.